Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Christ the King Anglican Church, totally on Zoom again for the first time for many, many months. And welcome to anyone who hasn't been with us before. We especially welcome Reverend Paul Bradbury, who arrived yesterday in the Algarve and will be here with us for three Sundays. Unfortunately, we can't meet in person today because there's a festa in the park for 3 days, but we will be back there next Sunday. You'll need a copy of the liturgy, and if you wish to partake of Holy Communion today, you will need small quantities of bread and wine, which will need to be consumed during the service. And could I ask everyone taking part in the service to unmute themselves when they see themselves appear on the screen? There will now follow a short period of silence to allow us to prepare ourselves for worship.
Well, good morning, everybody, and thank you all so much for welcoming me to the Algarve, particularly those who've been running around doing all sorts of things to enable me to be in this house and get myself organised for this morning. It's lovely to be with you. So my name's Paul. I'm an ordained minister based in the south of England, and I'm a pioneer minister, which you can ask me about that if you like, but at some point I'm sure we'll get to know each other. But basically, I don't have a parish, so I'm kind of exploring new ways of being church for people with no previous church connections. So I look forward to getting to know you over the next few weeks in various ways, and it's great to be with you this morning. So we're going to sing our first hymn, which is There Is a Redeemer.
God's own Son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. Jesus, my Redeemer, name above all names, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, oh, for sinners slain. Serve my King forever in that holy place. Thank you, oh my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit to the world. Precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. Thank you, oh my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit to the work on earth is done.
In the name of the Father, and of the Spirit, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with ye. We pray together the prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength." The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Amen.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all.
Almighty God, our heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour,
in thought and word and deed,
through negligence,
through weakness, through our own deliberate fault.
We are truly sorry
and repent of all our sins.
For the sake of your Son,
Jesus Christ,
who died for us,
forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory,
Of your name.
Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord God, your Son, left the riches of heaven and became poor for our sake. When we prosper, save us from pride. When we are needy, save us from despair, that we may trust in you alone, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Our first reading.
The Old Testament reading is taken from the book of Isaiah, Chapter 1, reading verse 1 and then continuing at verse 10. The vision concerning Judah and Jerusalem that Isaiah, son of Amoz, saw during the reigns of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom, and listen to the instruction of our God, you people of Gomorrah. The multitude of your sacrifices, what are they to me, says the Lord? I have more than enough of burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fattened animals. I have no pleasure in the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. When you come to appear before me, who has asked this of you, this trampling of my courts? Stop bringing meaningless offerings. Your incense is detestable to me. New moons and Sabbaths and convocations, I cannot bear your worthless assemblies. Your new moon feasts and your appointed festivals, I hate with all my being. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them all. When you spread out your hands in prayer, I hide my eyes from you. Even when you offer many prayers, I am not listening. Your hands are full of blood. Wash and make yourselves clean. Take your evil deeds out of my sight. Stop doing wrong. Learn to do right. Seek justice and defend the oppressed. Take up the cause of the fatherless and plead the case of the widow. Come now, let us settle the matter, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool. If you are willing and obedient, you will eat the good things of the land. But if you resist and rebel, you will be devoured by the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We're going to sing our next hymn, which is Seek Ye First. Gospel reading, which is from John chapter 2, verses 1 to 11.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John chapter 2, starting at verse 1.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Okay. On the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there. and Jesus and his disciples has also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied, "My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby stood 6 stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for the ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with the water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now." What Jesus did here in Cana of Galilee was the first of the signs through which he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you for reading that. I'm sure you've heard this passage many times before. Maybe you've heard sermons on this passage many times before, but it's one of those passages that seems to continue to reveal new things, new secrets. And I just want to offer a few points about faith, really, from this passage. It's John's first sign. So if you remember in John's gospel, there are 7 signs and 7 I ams. And there's lots of ways in which John uses his gospel basically to say who Jesus is. And this is the first of those 7 signs. It's the first story that John tells to say something of the uniqueness and the glory of who Jesus is. And you could summarize this story in this way. It's like the world is like a wedding that's supposed to be beautiful and joyous, but descends into something of a crisis. It's a crisis of the wine running out, which may not seem like a crisis. Well, maybe to some of us it is a crisis, but in a Jewish wedding, the wine running out is an absolute crisis. And yet in the midst of that crisis, Jesus comes and brings abundance. And this is the world that he invites us into. He invites us into a world that is in a sense in crisis, but in which he has come and brought the abundance of his grace. So that's the big picture. My first point is this, that crisis is where faith begins. Crisis is where faith begins. As I said, the wine running out at a Jewish wedding is a major disaster. The bridegroom has got one job. The bridegroom's job is to make sure there's enough wine, and he's messed up and there's not enough of it. And you can't just pop over to the supermarket and get some more. So it's a major disaster. And yet it's precisely at this moment of crisis that Jesus senses it's time to begin his ministry, to begin to say something of who he is. And it seems to me that that's actually a pattern about faith, that actually it's through crisis that faith is created, that faith is nurtured. Jesus is always putting his disciples into places of crisis so that they can learn faith, that they can learn to trust him. In the Beatitudes, it says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." And the Message translation, which you may well know, says this: You're blessed, is that, so this the translation of that verse. You're blessed when you're at the end of your rope. With less of you, there is more of God and his rule. So faith is nurtured, is created when we're at the end of our rope, not when things are going all swimmingly, but actually when we're at the end of our rope, because these are the situations that make space for God and for his rule. Well, it seems like a long time ago, but maybe being on Zoom today reminds us of those days when we were in lockdown. And when we first went into lockdown in the UK, it was a real crisis for us as a family. Well, it was a crisis for everybody, wasn't it? And I'm sure you have your own stories of what a difficult time that was. We have a son with a life-limiting lung condition. And so this pandemic, this virus, was obviously of huge concern for us and, of course, for him. And we were due to be in France, and so we cancelled that holiday, and then we went up north to Northumberland, so that, because we sensed that things were going to get a bit tricky and the university was going to close. My son was at Durham University at the time. And meanwhile, my daughter was in Kenya, and she was had to come home early from Kenya because they locked down. They told everybody to leave. And then my mother-in-law went into hospital with a heart problem and was in a bed in the ward next to someone who contracted the virus. So as you can imagine, it was a very, very uncertain time. There was a sense of real crisis as we sat there in this cottage in Northumberland, feeling like the world was falling apart. And just by chance, in a sense, we just looked for somewhere where we could stay that was near Durham, so that we could pick up our son Jacob from Durham when the university closed, as we thought it would. And we were overlooking in this cottage, which, as I say, was kind of like the only cottage that we could find available. We found ourselves overlooking Holy Island, Lindisfarne. And I'd always wanted to go to Lindisfarne, and I hadn't planned to go to Lindisfarne that week. It just happened that that's where we ended up. And in praying that week, I just sensed that God said to me, "I've brought you to Lindisfarne." And I sort of began to take notice of what it was, what it meant to be there. And of course, you may know that Holy Island has got this long history of Christian witness and mission to the UK. It's the place where saints came from Iona and around the top of Scotland and then down the east coast and then evangelized that part of the UK. And I just sensed that this had been a place of crisis before. Holy Island had been a place of crisis with raids from the Vikings and so on and so forth. And yet, through this crisis, this place had remained a place of witness and a place where the gospel had gone forth into the UK and brought the grace of God to people in Northumberland. And so out of crisis, out of uncertainty, the gospel came and brought life to many. And it was as if God was saying, this is a crisis, this is a time of great uncertainty, but I do some of my best work in times of crisis. The crisis is the crucible of faith. Secondly, faith is about making Jesus the main actor. I love this encounter between Mary and Jesus in verses 3-5. So here's Mary, the mother of Jesus, who spent the whole of Jesus's life up to that point, pretty much telling him what to do. I mean, she's his mother after all. So, come to dinner. Don't do that. Wash behind your ears. Have you washed your hands? All of those sorts of things that mothers say to their children. And then she brings this situation to him. And it's interesting that she doesn't tell him what to do. She just presents the situation to him. They have no more wine. And this is the moment when it seems to me that Mary turns from being a mother to being a disciple. From being the one, in a sense, telling Jesus what to do, to being the one who is now following Jesus and recognizing that she needs to follow in his footsteps, as it were. Jesus' response is to say, "My hour has not yet come." And you may know that in John's gospel, the word hour refers to the cross. It refers to the passion, to Jesus' death and resurrection. And so John places the first reference to the cross in the midst of this very early story of his ministry. And so while the cross is not yet, my hour has not yet come, Jesus says. In a sense, everything that now happens in terms of water into wine and so on and so forth is an anticipation of what the cross will do. He's starting his ministry, but it's leading up to the cross. It's saying everything I'm about to do sort of anticipates the cross and the climax of my ministry. And so wine, a symbol of God's blessing, will flow in this new kingdom, and Jesus will be the provider of that wine. Jesus, in a sense, is the bridegroom of the biggest wedding there is, and he's providing the blessing of the kingdom of God and asking us to come and be part of it. And so a key thing for us is making Jesus the main actor in our lives, letting him be in control of the situation. And it doesn't mean we have nothing to do in the kingdom. You know, Mary has agency in this story. She speaks to Jesus. She relays messages to the servants. She's part of what's going on. But it's very clear that Jesus is the main actor in this story. So how do we make Jesus the main actor in the story? Well, in a sense, it's very simple. It's about developing a life of prayer. It's a developing a life that gives space for God to be active in our lives. Stephen Cottrell, he's been Archbishop of York for a couple of years now, but he tells the story of when he was growing up, and he was at a scout camp. And a group of them were playing in the woods, and there were no adults there. This being, I don't know, the 1960s, when, you know, health and safety wasn't such an issue. And a boy fell from a tree, hit the ground, and lay completely motionless. And the boys thought he was dead. And so they ran, panic-stricken, across the fields to the scout camp where the leader was. And they all at once started shouting at the scout leader that that somebody had had a terrible accident, they were dead, and the scout leader needed to come as quickly as possible. And Stephen Cottrell said that the leader then actually calmly walked across this field that the children had run panic-stricken across. He walked very calmly across this field to the wood where the boy was. And the boy actually wasn't dead. He had just winded himself, and he needed a bit of help. He needed mouth to mouth. And then ultimately he was fine. And later the scout leader spoke to the boys. He reckoned probably correctly that the boys were pretty angry with him for not running, for not, you know, taking their anxiety and panic seriously enough. And he was right, they were. But the scout leader says, well, the reason I walked was this. I was thinking two things. Firstly, that I would need to do mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. And that secondly, I'd need my breath. And then secondly, I just needed time to consider my options, because I knew I'd only have one moment to decide what to do. And that could have been the difference between the boy's life and death. And Stephen Cottrell tells this story because it seems that one of the things about prayer is that it's about being unhurried and unanxious in a world that's very hurried and very rushed, and we run from one thing to another. And making Jesus the main actor in our life sometimes means slowing down enough to make space for God, to allow God to participate in our lives, to just be quiet for a moment in the midst of things that we are doing, to have practices and disciplines of prayer that create a kind of rhythm in our lives that allow God to be God and Jesus to be Jesus in our lives. And then finally, the third point is this, that the kingdom is a world of abundance. So we come on to the stone jars in verses 6 to 11. You may know these were jars that were there to hold water for washing hands and feet and utensils, so that all those things were clean. They were part of that whole system of ceremonial cleanliness that was the part of, that's part of the life of the Jewish people. And so without this water, life couldn't function. Unclean people had to isolate from everybody else. So these stone jars are, you know, absolutely central, in a sense, to making life possible in Jewish society. And Jesus asked them to be filled, and then the water is taken to the chief steward, and as we know, the wine is the best wine that one could possibly drink. So what does this sign mean? Well, I think it's saying that the wine of the blessing of the kingdom that Jesus brings replaces this endless functional system of needing to clean oneself all the time. The law that required you to constantly make yourself clean and acceptable to God is being replaced by a new age of blessing that comes through the ministry of Jesus. But some commentators actually think that when Jesus says draw water from the jars, it's a word that's only ever used for drawing water from a well. So Jesus is saying, he's asking the servants to go and draw water from the well outside and fill up these ceremonial jars from which the water will be drawn that's turned into wine. And so in that case, the story is saying that there is this endless source of life, this deep, deep well of life that Jesus is creating, that Jesus is bringing through himself, that will now be placed in, as it were, in the heart of the world, in the heart of creation, bringing abundant life to all who want to receive it. And I don't know about you, but one of the things that strikes me about the world we live in is that it's a world that's based on scarcity, that there's never enough. And so it's a very individualized world where everybody kind of competes for scarce resources and kind of hoards the stuff that they have and accumulates things. Consumerism encourages us to have more and more and more just in case we might run out. And we're constantly competing with other people for scarce resources. And it's such, in such great contrast to the kingdom of abundance that says there will be enough. The grace of God, the ministry of Jesus, the life that flows from the person of Jesus will never run out. And we can trust this life for all our needs. I think one of the effects of lockdown for me in our community was a sense that people glimpsed this life of abundance in their lives together, because we rediscovered, I don't know if this was the case here, I hope it was, but we rediscovered ourselves as neighbours, and we began to rely on each other in a way that we never used to rely on each other through a WhatsApp group and people sharing things and doing things for other people. And we got to know each other on our little street in Poole in Dorset. We got to know each other in a way that we'd never known one another before. And suddenly all that kind of running around, competing for resources, kind of simplified down to a small community of people supporting one another and having enough for one another. And one of the things that we did during that time, towards the end of that first lockdown, I sensed that that wonderful sense of abundance, that wonderful sense of neighbourhood was going to sort of peter out as people went back to their lives. And I thought to myself, how could we keep this wonderful sense of neighbourliness and community going? So we started a small community vegetable garden on this little strip of land in the street in Poole. And in the last two or three seasons since then, we've been growing vegetables together as a community on the street. and it's called BH15. That's the postcode, BH15, Grow Together. So it's about growing vegetables, but really it's about us growing together as a community. And we've tried to do that. I've tried to do that through a spirit of abundance by saying, you know, this is not about the vegetables. It's not about us growing vegetables so that we have vegetables for our tea. It's much more about growing together as people. And anybody can come and get vegetables, whether you work, whether you've done some work on the plot or not. It doesn't matter. It's there for everybody. And people have sort of really got hold of this idea, and they've been happy for anybody to come and enjoy some herbs or some tomatoes or some courgettes or whatever. And somebody once, I saw somebody on the plot once, and they apologized to me because they said, "Oh, I took some mint the other day. I'm terribly sorry. I took some mint because I don't do anything on the plot. But I took some mint the other day because I needed some for my gin and tonic or something." And I said, "That's fantastic." I said, "This is here for everybody. This is here to be a blessing for the whole community. It's here to be a place where people can come and get to know each other and sense something of the goodness of creation," I think I might have said. And in a really, really small, but I think significant way, what we've tried to do with that little community garden is show people something of the kingdom of abundance, something of a kingdom that's about people being together and having enough, and something of the grace of God that flows through the person of Jesus. And so back to the story, it may seem like a long way from this story, but I think it's the same. I think that's demonstrated something of this story, that in a situation of crisis and uncertainty, Jesus founded, he has founded a well of life, a flow of blessing that will never run out. And ultimately, that's what happens at the cross, that in a world of crisis and uncertainty, Jesus founds a well of life through the cross and resurrection, and that well of life will never run out. And that abundant life is there for you and for me and for us as a community and for the community around us. So those are my few points from John chapter 2. It's a shame not to be able to sort of interact with you a bit more and have a conversation. I love to have conversations about the Bible and what it means for us today. So we have just a moment's pause and reflection, and perhaps there might be just one or two things that have struck you in particular from the gospel reading this morning or from the other reading from Isaiah. So just a moment's quiet, and then we'll come to the Apostles' Creed. So let's join together and affirm our faith in the words of the Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Amen. Now Jane is going to bring us our intercessions.
Everlasting God, we join together in praying to you for the needs of the church, the world, our communities and ourselves, trusting in your love which reaches out from before the foundation of the world. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the church in the province of the West Indies. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, guard the church against self-righteousness and all rules and limits which you would not own, but keep always before us the rule of love. Help us to love and help each other, and remind us that sometimes all we need to do is offer a listening ear rather than voice an opinion. We especially pray for all our locums, particularly this month for Paul and his wife Emily, for Bishop Andy, our lay readers, our musicians, and all who faithfully put our services together each week. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Creator God, we pray for your world. Forgive us when we are ungrateful, when spiritual blindness prevents us from appreciating the wonder of your creation and the endless cycle of nature. Forgive us for taking without giving, reaping without sowing. We pray for the farmers of the world, many of whom still use those methods described by Jesus, and we especially pray that they may be treated with fairness for their labours. We particularly remember those who work with the land here in the Algarve, suffering so badly from drought, and our brave bombeiros keeping us safe. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father God, we thank you for the love we share with our families and friends. We recognise that we all have faults and they love us just in spite of ours. Help us to be flexible and adaptable in all of our relationships and also capable of accepting constructive criticism. When times are challenging, we remember that whatever difficulties we're facing, you are with us, you are in control, and we must place our trust in you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving God and Lord of life, we pray for the gift of courage to face up to and cope with illness. We pray for it for ourselves and for those who we now name before you, either in our hearts or out loud. We thank you for those who through their courage have come through illness and for those facing the reality that there is little light at the end of their earthly tunnel. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, give us ears to hear and minds to understand the message of immortality for the children of your kingdom, so that we may look forward with patience and confidence to that time when we will join you in the peace of eternity. We especially pray for any we know who have recently died and are on that journey to you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Faithful God, we thank you for the opportunity of being together in prayer, even though that we are physically apart. As we look forward to the week to come, we pray for an awareness of your love and support in all we do. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
So let's offer one another in a Zoom way. I'm not quite sure what you do at this point, but I'm sure there are ways we can share the peace with one another across Zoom. Going to stand up for this bit. You're sitting down so far because I'm still a bit tired from COVID, so but let's just still our hearts as we come to celebrate the passion of our Lord Jesus together. The Lord is here.
His spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things. He was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread, and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence
and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all those who share this one bread and one cup, so that we in the company of all the saints may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
As our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
So we pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I've had a very relaxed morning compared to a normal busy Sunday morning. Thank you, Paul, for this morning. We really look forward to meeting you in person next week, or maybe before. Special thanks to Colin for helping Jane set up Zoom on TV for her little congregation. Now, we have birthdays coming up next week for Anne and Christina. Parabéns. We will sing next week. And I think there is going to be a little celebration lunch when it's a bit cooler in September. Boa viagem, Sue and Terry, who will be away for the next three Sundays, and during their travels have arranged to visit Mike and Debbie. And also safe travels for the Stennings. Please check your emails, Facebook and web page for next week's events. Hope to see you all in person next Sunday at Church in the Park. Thank you.
Thank you, Sue. We're going to sing our final song, which is Lord, the light of your love is shining.
And so may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Amen. Amen.